That's an Indian Express tower. So what I'm here to share with you is, you know, how my higher education in India and studying anthropology and sociology has impacted my career. It was tough, as I mentioned. You probably heard my panel discussion and a little bit of introduction about myself. It was challenging those times, you know, for women to go into higher education, leave aside taking up studying anthropology. I had to explain to my parents and friends and family, what does anthropology mean? Study of humans, right? Yet, people want, you know, then on to journalism. I mean, what are you going to do? So it was a challenging time, those years where women never really pursued humanities, or if they did pursue humanities, it was only to establish good marriage and raise kids. I mean, that was our ultimate goal, right? But I'm here today to talk to you about a long journey that began in India and the many lessons I've learned along the way and how it has impacted and shaped who I am today as a design manager. So, oddly enough, I want to share with you some of the stories about my journey as a when I started off my career as a journalist in India. As a young journalist, and that too a woman journalist, I was tasked with a tough assignment, you know. I joined Indian Express and there was an increase of fatalities in slums in Mumbai. So my editor sent me to do a feature of childbirth in slums of Mumbai. For those that know Mumbai, you can imagine what it was like with this assignment. But I took it upon me. And I was scared. I was nervous. And in those times, unprepared for, you know, stepping into slums. So my job was to follow this midwife. And, you know, through the Dharavi and Bandra slums. And you can imagine, there was a call of screaming and yelling that came from one of the house. We dashed in and there was a woman in total distress and horrible condition lying on the path, bleeding. Fright and fear written all over her face. I was sick to my stomach, nauseated, wondering, you know, what am I, you know, short of fainting. But I had to take grip of myself. This was not about me. This was not about me at all. This was about this woman going through childbirth in slums. They gave me a chair, made me sit next to her. I put my notebook down and I held her hand. But what I experienced that day really taught me about connections, making connections, the empathy. And that lesson has guided me till today. It really made me realize that when we talk about empathy, it was a lesson in empathy, understanding who you are, who your users are. It was a tough lesson, but I can tell you, I was able to write a great expose that really revealed how childbirth in slums happens. So that is how I learned the primary lesson of ethnography, of user research, and how you really begin connecting with your users. So my first, I missed out talking to you about where I migrated. So now I work in USA, Oracle, that's my team in USA, and I work as part of the advanced research. So like I was saying, here's a lesson, an example of the slums of Mumbai. You know, this is not the picture taken when I was there. Certainly they were evolved now, and they certainly have better signpostage, but empathy. So this is the principle that has guided me. I really feel this principle still stays very close to my heart because it's the essence of innovation, design inspiration, and solution, building the right solution. Once you understand and relate to your users, you know what you have to build. This ability to connect and understand the world that we live in really is the proof for designers. I say that's the crux of design. Today, it's a challenge because user research is always compromised. Time, agile methodologies, the time to rush to market, and maybe roll out the products even before they've been tested and vetted really is the challenge of our time. So keeping a focus on who the users are, what they need, is a challenge. But I say don't give up that challenge, because time and time again, I've seen the products being come back, redesigned, redone again, because the user research was not done. So do not compromise. Anytime projects that compromise make assumptions about who your users are, what the problem that you're solving, if you really don't understand the purpose of your product, don't even go further. That's my key role. So I want to quickly say that this lesson has taught me, and throughout as I've gained experience in this field, I've never lost my sight towards this. And really, despite all the challenges, I've succeeded in making sure that I really questioned until I've understood the user. Even if I don't have the time to go out and do the research that I have to be, I challenge my managers, I challenge the customers to understand, to tell me if they don't give me the right requirements, if they don't tell me who my users are, I can't design the product right for them. So this is one of the principles that I have I've learned. The second thing that I've learned along the way in enterprise application, when I started working in one of the large enterprise companies, I was probably the only human factors engineer hired. It was a company created by an engineer, co-founded by an engineer, run by an engineer and developed, and they're really bright people. The product was very successful. They migrated from green screen to Windows-based product. My challenge was to make the product usable, right? And my first task was to redesign the interface. So I redesigned the interface, and it was a big success. I was invited, our whole team was invited to the founder's home for dinner. He introduced me as the woman who made my software look pretty. I took that as a compliment and a challenge, because I knew that the usability problems in that product were many. And to understand that the complexity they had built in over and over again with patches and adding feature functions, really, you lost who, you know, it was my inability to understand what were people doing with this product. So I started asking questions. I need to talk to customers. I need to talk to people that use this application to be able to understand what's wrong with this product. After many, many complaints, you know, everybody would tell me it's not usable, there's people this, what can you do about it, etc. Finally, there were some customers in South Carolina who invited me to come and see. You can imagine South Carolina a few years ago. I know things are improving in the US, but they're also still challenging. When I went there in this office, I could see that other than the receptionist, there were no women in the office, you know. I was supposed to follow a purchase officer, basically a purchasing manager, and understand the contract negotiation phase. You know, we're building a purchasing solution. From the beginning, when I met this manager, he was the team lead for his team. I was supposed to sit with all the purchasing managers. I faced a lot of resistance. Why are you here? Why is an Indian woman here? And why are you interested in my job? So it took me a lot of struggle, strength, and courage to start stick through that whole week, follow him around, follow his team around, trying to understand what they're doing with the product, what kind of pains are they having, and where are the, you know, opportunities for us to improve the design. After a good hard week of it ended up in a happy note. When I debriefed him and gave him my assessment of his task flow, where are the gaps, where are the pain points, and an assessment of the task flow of what he was doing, and where are the opportunities for improvements, he looked at me very strangely. I thought, he's very upset, something is wrong. And he said, ma'am, nobody studied my job in such a detailed way. And I took that as a compliment. But yes, it entered us with a good handshake. I went off with a great amount of information back to my development team and was able to design the solution, which was really actually a much useful solution that met his needs. I went back once before and I was treated very well after that experience. But this whole cycle taught me one thing, the second lesson in my career, which is grit and perseverance, staying focused on that user's goal. It wasn't easy coming back and trying to make a change in that years of design that the engineers had created to make them redesign the product from grounds up, because it was designed wrong. It was designed with the feature functions in mind rather than the task flow in mind. When I changed it completely to the task flow in mind, it was a lot of work for designers, admittedly. We had a whole release. This whole effort required developments and managerial support, but it required my grit, perseverance, to push this change within the application. It's not easy. Even the founder who once invited me to his house as a lady who made the software beautiful wondered, what was I doing there? But the product was successful, and I was allowed to hire more people. That was, to me, a success factor because, you know, I was able to bring in a team of people, and I actually came to India to hire my first UX team. The second lesson, as I've learned in my design management career, of course, you hear pursue it with passion, but what do I mean by that? Actually, passion, I've learned to passion and appreciation, I want to say. Because what I've done, as I've hired people from multiple disciplines, I've realized that our discipline is a multidisciplinary field. And everybody brings a tremendous amount of strength. Visual designers, cognitive psychologists, social scientists, computer scientists, visual designers, even information architects, management, business, everybody brings contribution. So when you interview people, depending on what your needs are, don't exclude people that come from humanities or liberal arts background, because they have a contribution to make in this field. The key thing is, what are they doing? What is the skill set they're bringing? Are they strong in the skill set? Do they understand the broad knowledge required to design a solution? You know, design requires a really broad knowledge. We sometimes think, you know, wireframing, if you understand the tool Azure, and you think we'll make good designers. Actually, it takes us much more to understand what it takes to make a successful design. And that really requires working as a collaborative team. You know, I have product managers here from Oracle. I've worked with product managers and trying to educate them in user experience, and I'm so happy to see you here, because I think more and more product managers, project managers, engineers, if they understand your domain and you understand their domain, there's a wonderful handshake that can happen, which is we all work as a team to design the best solution. There's no us versus them, it's we. We are designing the product and the solution. So this is the passion that kind of I feel has driven me to where I find that now as a design manager, I'm moving more into impacting the future minds. And I want to say this, that this appreciation of the broad discipline, I want to see that expanded in young children. There is a focus still in technology being the driver of solution. And I agree, technology is a driver of solution. So I'll give you a good story, an interesting story of my experience when I've gone to Mexico. I have a team in Mexico as well, in Guadalajara. And I was asked to judge a Technovation competition. Technovation, I don't know if you've heard, this is a program all around, it's a global program where they're encouraging children to innovate. You know, young children, high school children, middle school children, particularly girls. And the reason why I was invited is I was a woman, a designer. So they invited me. I was impressed. These girls, these were high school girls, they were asked to build a product that would help their communities. And we were asked to judge on it. I was impressed by the entries and the amount of work that these girls, the passion that they brought to the table. And what was interesting to me is that as judges, we were all called to give our feedback to the girls of how the project was, how it ran, and give them some inspiration. The judges that went before me spoke in Spanish, so I didn't understand what they were saying. I don't speak or understand Spanish. I want to learn. But when it came to my turn, I just talked about how impressed I was with their design thinking, with their passion, what they brought to solve problems in their community. The winning team had done a design on how to for girls to press a few keys in their cell phone to alert if they were in a dangerous situation. So really, they were solving real problems. And I was applauding them for pursuing their passion. I said, go for it. Don't worry about it, don't go. Because these girls, I noticed, had a very creative mind. They didn't want to be pushed into careers of technology or science or engineering. And when I stopped talking and I thanked them for it, there was a huge applause. And I wondered, what was the applause for me or them? And one of the judges came and told me, he says, you spoke exactly opposite what we were telling them. We were telling them, girls must code. And this is the whole thing, where we are pushed as women to go into technology to learn code. We must learn to program. There's a whole initiative in the US called STEM. I don't know how many of you have heard about STEM. STEM is science, technology, engineering, math. It's a wonderful course, and certainly it's encouraging women to get out, come into the technology field and contribute, and I totally applaud that. But it's missing one concept, A. So now STEAM has changed, STEM has changed into STEAM, science, technology, arts, and math. And I think that's an amazing, that's the most important contribution. And that's what I feel is that arts, humanities, makes a tremendous contribution to design thinking. And that's really where design thinking really begins to change. When you've heard in this conference, I think a lot, where people have done very successfully, but what's missing is cognitive, you know, understanding of human beings. I think that cognitive understanding of human beings is really what we need in our field. And the more and more we educate ourselves, the more and more we are welcoming to people that are coming from humanities, from liberal arts background, you know, arts design background, I think they have a tremendous contribution to make. So even though my journey was tough in this year, I came from humanities and struggled to survive in engineering field, I say that in the future, the next generation should be welcoming to that, and there should be a wonderful merge of the two, science and math, to create this design thinking, which is what drives our product solution. So I hope my story is an inspiration, that no matter what you pursue, where you come from, if you like science, if you like programming, go for it. I don't say that that's not a right track. What I'm saying is, if you have a creative mind, if you come from a visual arts background, and you want to move into this field, yes, there is room for you. Yes, there is a contribution you can make. You just have to follow your passion and move and go towards making design successful, because everybody of us have made a contribution. Thank you. Design thinker, very good question. I think design thinking involves really getting to the crux of the matter. You know, to be able to grasp and analyze. I think comes back to critical thinking, right? Because the ability to quickly analyze a problem. You know, when I go to customer sites and we kind of, you know, hear problems with our software, and there are many. We try to nail down very quickly, was the product customized? Who really using the product? How many complaints they're getting? You've got to be able to have that design thinking requires us to quickly grasp and analyze the problem. So can everybody be? Yeah, if you have critical thinking skills, you can be a good design thinker. Why is that enterprise products make such good money despite design thinking?
Because then they won't want to invest in most of them are 40 years old.
Very true. I don't know how to answer this question. But I'll do my best. Yes, they make money. They make money out of feature functions. Because the industry, it's really a vicious problem. If you ask the buyers who buy this product and make, you ask them why they're buying feature functions. They're still competitive. So-and-so is offering more, what are you offering? If the scale is more feature, more functionality versus user experience, then you are going to pick the feature, right? So my job has also been to educate our customers. You know, I've created a program called UX Direct, which in Oracle is educating the customers once we roll out and sell the product. You know, many people go, why are you going out? We've sold the product. But the product, is it adopted? Is it just sitting on their desk? Is it being used to its full capacity? We need to explore that until we have that information. So it's a vicious cycle. I think consumers have got to become, consumers of enterprise products have to demand the same amount of user experience that consumer products have. Correct. And believe me, it's happening. Customers are becoming more aware, you know, as technology is getting in more and more hands, people are comparing quality products, customers are getting savvy, even if they don't know or understand fully. So they are demanding products that have a good user experience. They want to have, so it will come. But I think the fact that they make money, they have potential of making more money if the user experience is good. Because in a way, user experience has become a differentiator. So it can make more money if they only understood that it's not feature, but user experience as well that sells.
Can I make one question? I just have one question. Okay, I can take two questions.
Okay,
so my question is, like, when we talk about design, we say, you know, think creative, think out of the box. So what we do is, like, we tend to automate things. And then when you go to the user, say, like, your job is automated, the user says, I don't like it, you know, because he gets afraid of losing his job. Kind of, we're automating more things and all, we are creating at the same time a backlog of unemployment. So how do we handle the situation? Because now if you see Tesla itself, it's a driverless car. So what are we doing? Actually, we are creating an unemployment for some people.
But an opportunity in another area. I think that's what, as designers, we need to think about. We're solving a problem that's mundane. Maybe driving is mundane. I want to talk, I want to listen to music, I want to do other things. Why should I focus on driving? It's stressful. Driving in Hyderabad, I mean, if somebody could drive for you, why do you want to focus on driving? You want to be working and doing things that you love. So I think we have to make our users, whose job that we're automating, think differently, and I think that's an important message. We as user experience people don't take it to the end users. When we market our product, we have to market in a way that the improvements you make actually are going to make their lives better so they can pursue the things they want to pursue. Not do the mundane jobs that they have required, you know, enterprise software or, you know, have to drive the cars that are. So I think it's an inspiration to change thinking. That's
where
out of the box comes in,
is
to change the mindset of our users. I face that problem, but yes, that's the way I
would do it. Yeah, good question. I want to know, now you are a director of universities. So what are the challenges that you face, you know, in different kind of geographical locations, and, you know, in terms of the UX solution kind of provided or the design thinking? How do you actually tackle them, or do they come to you ever, or they are resolved or resolved at the,
I don't flatter myself they'll come to me every time the situation happens. I go to them. I try to see what are some of the challenges. I see that technology and the new cutting edge always drives people, you know. There'll be people that see augmented reality, we see bots coming, we see all these solutions coming, and people rush to build products out of that. Whether there is the design thinking involved in that development of the product is not part. So I insert myself in innovation labs. And I'm like, have you ever thought about what solutions you're solving? Where's your use case? Where's your user? What's the problem? So I'm known for a rebel culture in a very subtle way. So I insert myself. We have a design lab, and when they give tours, I go into tours, and then I'll ask questions saying, do you know? And that way I get invited back into those labs and say, okay, well, tell us, show us how. So
whatever you're doing, so how to do from offshore?
Outsource?
Yeah.
From India?
Yes.
Yeah.
See, you are from US, so you can able to do whatever, like, repel and everything. So I'm sitting here in India, because whatever the product owners or product manager is telling, so that's what we need to know. Okay, so based on that only we need to decide.
You know, it's not about location anymore. One thing I tell you, a tip that I taught my India team, and they became successful and left and moved on.
Just teach me anything.
They actually, what I taught them is to ask questions. If they didn't understand, I said, don't go into just a yes mode. You know, we have this culture of yes, ma'am, yes, ma'am. I said, no, what do you mean yes? Do you really understand and agree with me?
Wait, what's
so they learn to ask questions.
What's happening in my organization? I'll take it off.
Yeah, we'll take it off. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thanks, Madhuri.